of Huddersfield is the biggest yawn of all. That's a pity because they're quite famous names and the shops lining it. Thank God for the hills at the end. That's all that redeems it. Oh, come on, you know. Just across from here is a bank which has been constrained into this idle grid, but is really fighting mad to get out in the town and do something with the town, not just be a kind of dumb waiter. And at the end of that street was, until 1930, Huddersfield's one grand gesture before the 19th century, before the railway station. And that was the cloth hall, which is a kind of combination of Covent Garden for cloth and a stock exchange. It was oval. It looked pretty much like a bullring. Grim enough, but very, very strong. They re-erected bits of it with all the commemorative plaques. There's a shelter in a public park about a mile and a half away. That's not the same, mates, really. It begins to look like a permanent conflict between inward Huddersfield and outward Huddersfield. And the one place where modern architecture has really thought about the inner Huddersfield is in the new market hall. The designer here had a really difficult problem. It was a sloping site into which she had to fit this market hall. Though the outside is a bit glam, it really went to work on the inside. The firm is J. Seymour Harris. We do a lot of town centre schemes up and down the country. And whoever was the designer in that firm really did Huddersfield proud here. To cope with the slope and to fit everything in, he used concrete mushroom columns, regular intervals. Mushroom because they splay out at the top. And this could have been a structural gimmick, but here it's used to define spaces, to relate them, to bring the light in from the top so that you're at one with the building itself. That combined with the fact that the stalls are not regimented, they've been given a good deal of freedom in the way you can decorate them, has made it a marvellously human place. Really the opposite of most indoor shopping centres. It is, in fact, and this is pretty rare in Britain, a real modern market. When you go out of the market on one side straight away, you're up against the flat side of Huddersfield's town hall. Flat again, saying nothing. It's the Huddersfield disease almost. And just once more, inside, things are much grander because the hall in there is a really majestic bit of architecture, and it's also the place where the Huddersfield Choral Society performs a lot of the time. So in a way you can feel Messiah vibrating from the inner heart of an apparently blank building. Town Hall is Huddersfield's little bit of pedestrian precinct. This is the end of the long yawn. It's the same street as I started with by the station. And here, after this, Huddersfield simply falls off into first mills and then moors. It's a tiny area, really. It's much less than half a mile, this whole trip. You may feel I've been rabbiting on forever and grousing about the yawns of Huddersfield. And you've got every right to ask, well, all right, what the hell do I do about it? For a start off, you could get what's left of the cloth hall back right here. It's doing no good out there. And although these seats are fine, there is no covered place you can sit in this little bit. In this particular part, there's no reason at all why the buildings have to be this dead straight. It's really dead boring, this lot. The only reason is the inability of men's minds to adapt. It's always been straight, it's always got to be straight. You could build buildings across the end, for example, here. But all that really is cosmetic stuff. I think outward Huddersfield has probably gone too far to save. The bits I'm really interested in, the bits I've tried to show, are the inward bits, all the little bits. One I didn't show, probably the best of all, a thing called Market Avenue, which must have led down to the old market. And there you can really feel that there is a special separate world going on away from these windy streets. That's the kind of thing that needs to be linked up to all the other special worlds that are so far unrelated, a separate second inward Huddersfield. That's what we've got to build on. Sorry, I've only shown you a bit of the town centre, when there is, in fact, very much more than that. An enormous scale, hills to hills. Thing is, I got carried away, because where people normally go to town centres to shop or have a meal, I go there to read them like a detective novel, to try and unravel what's gone wrong, what's gone right, how the shape is. And that's what happened in Huddersfield this week. For some people it's football, for me this is really the greatest game in the world. I'm off now just over there, over the hills, to try and do the same thing for Halifax. But one last thing in Huddersfield, if you've got a view as splendid as this, please don't build houses like those over there to look at it, because a view is a two-way responsibility. It's great for you, you can gaze out of a Huddersfield. Huddersfield has got a look at you, and the sight isn't very nice. Pennine weather. The game that Halifax Town play here, that is, the game the football ground plays, is a bit odd. Because after the match on Saturdays, the area around, down just down here, becomes a speedway. And alongside Sunday mornings is a miniature Petticoat Lane open air market. This kind of multiple use is the thing that ought to happen much more often at football grounds, and very rarely does. This mixture, this jumble, certainly not beautiful, but I do find it fascinating. It grows on you. And what also grows is the surprising difference between one ground and another, between the flat surroundings of Huddersfield and this ravine-like feeling here in Halifax. And as it turns out, it's just the same as the railway stations. Well, you can't win them all. To be fair, there's been a scheme for a hotel and offices here on the stops for years. It's waiting for money like the rest of us. In fact, I like this. Unpretentious. And what it does marvellously is give foreground scale to the hills, rising behind, rearing right up. Because Halifax really is one of the most dramatic town sites anywhere in Britain. You know, you go to Durham on its rock, but how many people really come to see Halifax on its hill? Well, that's looking that way. If the football fan came out of the station, in Huddersfield he'd have found a solid, comfortable Victorian square. In Halifax, his first sight would be something looks very like a bit of recent bomb damage. It's like Armageddon in here, all the calcined pews and roof beams. This is, was, a congregational church. And this was an accidental fire. The church had been closed and nobody knows how it started. Act of God, you might say. It was quite a building, mid-Victorian, with a colossal steeple. A very unusual thing for a nonconformist church to do. They, at one time, after the fire, hoped that they could save the steeple. Now they think the whole lot's got to come down. Well, if it's dangerous, and certainly bits of it look a bit rocky, too bad. If it wasn't, though, it's a funny thing, we're so afraid of ruins. We go by the thousand to look at ruins like Tintern and Revo and Fountains Abbey. But when we have the chance of making a modern ruin with a building pretty powerful. That steeple is really malevolent up there. It's a touch of the Heathcliffs up there. We don't bother. And there are, in fact, here two congregational churches, because when they built this one in the 1850s, they left the old one, the Georgian one, and used it as a Sunday school. And they're hoping to save the old one, but they better be quick, because it's open, anyone can get in. And it's looking pretty derelict now. And that would be a pity, because Halifax hasn't got too many Georgian buildings left over to pull one down. But the greatest Georgian building, in fact, is just behind. It may look like a big blank wall from outside, but the inside is something else. And this isn't Armageddon, in spite of appearances. It takes a bit of explaining. This is the Peace Hall, which is where, in the 18th century, people who then made their cloth way out in the country came to display it and sell it. It gradually became redundant as the mills were built and things were centralized. And what happened was in the 1860s, it was turned into Halifax's wholesale market. And that has just now moved out. It's a sort of Covent Garden situation. So all this demolition is simply all the sheds in the middle that used to house the market traders. The hall itself is going to be retained. Not only that, it's at this very moment being renovated. They haven't, in Halifax, waited for years while it gradually deteriorated, and thank you, Halifax, for that. What'll happen is that all the buildings around the colonnade here become offices, the centre of car park, which is fine, it's a decent use. But also, just look at it, just look at the scale of it. It is, in fact, a perfect stage set. There is nothing quite on this scale anywhere I know in England. Well, this was the 18th century's grand gesture in Halifax. The 20th century has done just the same, right in the centre. For most people, Halifax is the Halifax, the building society, that is. They say it's the biggest in the world, and I wouldn't disbelieve them. They've just rebuilt themselves here, and I've seen the building slated in at least one newspaper as being a vast monument to commerce. I think they're wrong there for two reasons. One is that a place like Halifax needs monuments desperately. You know, the City of London's got too many, not enough little streets. Halifax needs a 20th century equivalent of the Peace Hall. And the other is it's a very odd kind of monument, because it dominates, which is pretty rare, this, it dominates not through brutality, but through strength. Whether it's close to and the little houses down the road there, the podium lifts and floats above them. It is enormous, there's no denying that. Or whether you're in the center of Halifax and it just edges into the view, not violently, just saying, hello, Halifax, I'm here. The only bit I don't like much is this abstract sculpture at the front here. It really does seem to symbolize brutality rather than strength. It is, in fact, extract ducting for the floors underground. There's three floors down under this, machinery in that, pumping out CO2. It's a brave try to combine things in this way. I don't think myself it's come off, but it was worth trying. The architects, they also did the Preston bus station. And for any one firm to have done two buildings of that scale and quality in 10 years, I would call myself a lifetime's achievement. Perhaps the nicest thing of all is that because they've used dark tinted glass here in the entrance, you get a reflection of Victorian Halifax, the like of which I've never seen. We'll be right back. real touchstone of a town is what it feels like when the people aren't there. It's Halifax Market on early closing day. And though there's nobody about, the padlocked stalls here still seem to be bursting with the energy of the goods inside them. All that energy is splendidly overlooked by the energy of the building itself. Well, you just look at all this. England's got a marvellous legacy of these cast iron Victorian market halls, but this must surely be one of the best. And it's the only one I know where the central feature is a splendid ornamental clock, which ties the whole thing together. They call the shop Under the Clock, and that must be a meeting place for thousands of people. It looks as splendid as it does through the redecoration. And they normally are like, not pastel or soft colours, but black and crimson and gold. The man who did this was a genius. He's playing oranges and lemons in a way. And they also somewhere near the colours of the Halifax buses. He wasn't a renowned designer. His name is Len Smith, and he works for Halifax Corporation. And well done, Mr. Smith. And there you are, you see. Just a hint of colour on the gates of the market hall, indication of what's going on behind, and the rest quite polite. There's nothing happening back there. This is the equivalent of the main street of Huddersfield. And even though this is about as empty as it possibly can be, as I said, it was half closing, it still seems to have much more energy than Huddersfield had. The buildings are a bit closer. It's not absolutely dead straight. There's always something to lead you around the corner, lead you on. So this street isn't one long yawn like Huddersfield. The biggest part of that really is that at the end there's something to look at, not just empty space, nothingness. That's Halifax Town Hall. It was Sir Charles Barry's last building, the bloke who did the Houses of Parliament. And I think really, because it was completed by his son, I think Dad had lost a bit of interest and let his son go a bit fancy free there, because it's rather a naughty silhouette. It's not very strict, which Barry was. As I said, everything in the Halifax garden isn't rosy. Downhill a few yards from the town hall, it's desolation. And this was medieval Halifax. This is the original town. Now all that's left is the black and strong but rather lonely church down there, which is big and medieval. The rot started early because the mills moved in very close, rather as it did in a bigger scale in Bradford. But even so, it's a pity it's all gone. And come to that, just round here also, the bit of modern Halifax is in some little trouble. What happened was that it was intended to collapse into its own fundament, you know, collapse inward. Instead of that, it just gave a little tilt and stayed there. I suppose in the end they've got to demolish it. It's part of Halifax old power station. But, oh, there's so much of me wishes they would leave just that one there as the leaning tower of Halifax. Down there is the whole of Halifax, everything from the cooling towers through the ruined church, Peace Hall, Halifax Building Society, right round to the football ground. This view from the east side, from South Arum, the centre of Halifax, must be one of the most dramatic in Britain. And all around, on every side, the moors. Pennine country, Bronte country. A few yards up here, Law Hill House. Emily, in fact, was a school teacher for some time. I think you would guess from the programme that for me Halifax has won. I'll do it goal by goal. To start with, comparing like with like, Halifax Station, nothing much there compared with the palace of Huddersfield Station, so that's one to Huddersfield. Back to Halifax with the Peace Hall, about to be very well restored, compared with Huddersfield's demolition and then reduction to a tiny little shelter in a public park. That's one to Halifax, one all. Market halls, Halifax's Victorian, gay, frilly. Huddersfield's concrete, brand new, very humane and understanding to all. One more to Halifax for the new building of the Halifax Building Society, which is a splendid modern building by any standards. And then about another two goals for Halifax, for the way that although a lot has gone, it still expresses itself. So the final score will be something like 5-2, because Halifax has expressed itself and Huddersfield hasn't. And without you express the whole town, you might as well not have started planning at all.